The size of a result set has a huge impact on the performance of a query, the burden it puts on your Java application, and the user experience your UI provides. It's a general best practice to split huge result sets into multiple parts presented on separate pages. This process is called pagination. Hi, I'm Torben Janssen, and I'm here to show you how to use Hibernate more efficiently. In this video, we will take an in-depth look at pagination with JPA and Hibernate. But before we start, if you are new here, please subscribe and click the bell to get new videos every week. And also don't forget to like this video if you found it helpful. The most common way to implement pagination using a relational database is to add a limit and offset clause to the SQL query. The limit defines the maximum number of records that shall be returned. The offset clause specifies how many records shall be skipped before the first record gets returned. As long as you ensure a stable ordering of the result set, you can use these two clauses to scroll through the result set. You can, of course, use pagination with JPA and Hibernate. The easiest way to do that is to add the limit and offset clauses to a native SQL query. JPQL and the Criteria API don't support these two clauses as part of the query, but they provide an API to set them. Hibernate will then add the required clauses to the generated SQL statement. Let's get to the IDE and take a look at that. JPA and Hibernate are designed as a leaky abstraction and enable you to execute any SQL query supported by your database. You only need to call the createNativeQuery method on your entity manager with an SQL statement. That enables you to use database-specific features like PostgreSQL's JSON support. You can also execute SQL update statements or select statements with a limit and offset clause. If you provide an entity class as the second parameter to the createNativeQuery method, every record of the result set gets automatically mapped to an entity object. If you want to use a different mapping, for example to a DTO class, you can reference an SQL result set mapping instead. The downside of this approach is that every DBMS supports a slightly different SQL dialect. Hibernate doesn't change the provided SQL statement. It only sends it to the database. You therefore need to make sure that you use the right dialect for your DBMS. This can be problematic if you need to deploy your application using multiple DBMS. You can avoid this by using the setFirstResult and setMaxResults method on the query interface. Hibernate then uses the database dialect to generate the required SQL clauses. For a PostgreSQL database, these are an offset clause with the value provided to the setFirstResult method and a limit clause with the value supplied to the setMaxResults method. As mentioned earlier, JPQL doesn't support limit and offset clauses, but you can use the same setFirstResult and setMaxResults method of the query and type query interface that I showed you in the previous section. Hibernate then uses the configured dialect to add the required SQL clauses to the generated statement. For a PostgreSQL database, these are the limit and offset clause you can see in the following snippet. When you execute a criteria query, you instantiate the same query or type query interface as you use for a JPQA query. Because of that, you can use the already explained setFirstResult and setMaxResult methods to add pagination to your criteria query. Hibernate then uses the configured dialect to generate the required clauses and adds them to the SQL statement. As you have seen, using pagination with Hibernate and JPA is simple, but there are a few pitfalls you need to be aware of. By calling the setFirstResult and setMaxResults methods on your query interface, you tell the database the index of the first and the last record of the result set it shall return. If you want to scroll through the entire result set, you need to execute the query multiple times and provide different values to the setFirstResult and setMaxResults methods. To ensure that this approach works as expected, you also need to ensure that the query always returns the result in the same order. This is only the case if your query contains an order by clause. Otherwise, the order of the result set is undefined and might change. If your query returns entity objects, you can use an entity graph or a join fetch clause to specify the associations that shall get initialized. This, of course, affects the generated SQL statement. Hibernate needs to add a join clause for each of the retrieved associations, which increases the size of the result set. When you add pagination to this query, you will see the following warning in the log file. The fetched associations increase the size of the result set. If Hibernate would apply pagination to this query, it would no longer return the expected result. Because of that, Hibernate has to retrieve all records of the result set and apply the pagination in memory. You can avoid this problem by splitting your query into two. The first one uses pagination to get a list of the records' primary keys that match your search criteria. You can then use this list in the second query to retrieve the entities with their initialized associations. Pagination is a simple but important feature to limit the size of your result set to a number of records that can get efficiently processed by your application and the user. You can configure it with JPA and Hibernate by calling the setFirstResult and setMaxResults methods on the query and type query interface. When you use pagination, you need to add an order by clause, and you should try to avoid it when using join fetch clauses or an entity graph. Okay, that's it for today. If you want to learn more about Hibernate, you should join the free member library. It gives you free access to a lot of member-only content, like cheat sheets and ebooks about JPA and Hibernate. I'll add the link to it to the video description below. And if you liked today's video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe below. Bye!